We're here to talk about application monitoring. We have a few sessions on that. A little bit about my background. Is it okay if I move around? I think so. I hope so. So I've been doing application monitoring for 10 years. I work for Dell. Used to work for a company called Quest that got bought by Dell last year. How many people here have heard of Dell? Dell Computers. Hope so. Yes. And we have a big software division, so that's what we're talking about. I've been working on this thing called Foglight that nobody will have heard of for a number of years. I've had a lot of exposure to different kinds of customers doing application monitoring and management over more than 10 years now. I used to be a Java developer. Before that, I was a C++ developer. Before that, I was a C developer. So I am a software background guy, but I have done a lot of speaking engagements. So that's why I'm here. And we're going to talk about application performance management. We're going to introduce the problem, because a lot of people, especially when you're in school, you don't even know what the problem is yet. We're going to talk about the different types of monitoring. We're going to define what an application is, and also what application performance management is. And then we're going to talk about different approaches to this. Okay? So, this is, everybody here must be a software developer of some kind. You're all writing computer programs in different courses. And this is what a software developer thinks about their software. They think their software runs on a computer, and you run it, and it does something. It produces a result. And it runs kind of in isolation. So you run it on your laptop, and it works. Or maybe you run it in the cloud on a single instance. So this is a good model for when you're getting started learning how to program, but it's not reality. The reality is a lot more complicated. In reality, your code does not run on a single box. When you use it in the real world, it gets deployed to multiple machines. This is called scalability. So your code may be running on 3 web servers inside of an application, and that application may have different layers to it that you don't deal with normally, but they get added to the system. There may be external web services. You may have to talk to another application. In fact, I'll restate that. You will have to talk to another application that you don't write. Someone else writes something and you have to ask it questions. This is normal, but this is not what you've been exposed to so far. Application code that you write is just a tiny part of the picture. When we're talking about applications that get run in the real world, the picture is much larger. So when you write software, you're not done. You're not done at all. You've only just started. If your software does something that people actually care about, you need to keep that software running, which is actually harder than you might think. You need to make sure that it's running. If it stops running, or if it has an error, or if there's a change, you have to do something. You have to start it. You have to rewrite it. You have to give it more resources. You have to take phone calls if somebody doesn't like it. Maybe it runs correctly, but it's too slow. Maybe there are software upgrades that make your software not work anymore. Maybe the hardware fails, and you have to run that software on another machine. Most software developers, especially in school, don't think about this at all. But it's really important to understand that successful software requires a lot of attention. We say care and feeding. You have to care for it. You have to feed it resources. You have to make sure that it's doing its job. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay, good. So that's what we're going to talk a lot about today. So different types of activities. One is the word monitoring, and one is management. So monitoring is gathering data to make sure that something is working. So you may look at a web application and just make sure that the main page is still working. And you may time how long that page takes to run. That's monitoring. Management does all of that, but then it adds on the plan for doing something if it doesn't work. So if that page doesn't respond, then maybe you have to go and gather a different piece of data. Is the computer running? If the computer's running, then you have to find out if the software has crashed. If the computer's not running, you have to go and reboot it or find another computer to run it on. This is called, in our business, we call this a runbook. You would implement this runbook, and you would have a series of actions that are required when you notice a problem. There are different types of management that are important. So this session talks about the different types of management that you'll see in the real world. There's infrastructure management, virtual infrastructure management, network, storage, database, and application. I'm going to define all of these. So infrastructure management is really concerned with the hardware and operating system. So these are the computers, the systems that you're running on. Now, as we'll see later, the hardware becomes less and less important in today's real world. When I was starting out as a software developer, there was always a physical computer that you could touch. You actually had to go and turn it on or turn it off or put CDs or tapes into it. Believe it or not, tapes. So when we're talking about the hardware, though, we're talking about the availability of the system. Is it up and running? Are there any problems with it? Is it overheating? Is it too hot? Is one of the CPUs going to crash? How much power is it consuming? On top of the hardware is the operating system itself. So Linux or a kind of Unix or Windows, if you have to. And operating system talks or allows you to look at different kinds of resource consumption. So how much CPU are you using? How much memory are you using? And you can see all the processes that are running on that machine. The person who cares, so I have these little sections on all my slides. It says persona. Has anyone seen this word before, persona? A persona is a type of person. Okay, so a professor is a persona, or a professor of IT is a persona. So these are types of people that I meet and Yinghua meets and Joe meets in our job. They're people who buy our software. So the IT administrator is a persona who is mostly concerned with infrastructure management. So they care an awful lot about the operating system and the physical hardware. They talk a lot about systems and different size systems. They're the kind of person who would know how many units a certain kind of Dell hardware piece is. They are likely certified in some way with operating systems, so they'll be a Microsoft certified engineer, or they'll have certain Linux training. And what's interesting about this persona is they don't really care about the application at all. They think that all that stuff you're running is kind of a nuisance. It's like a virus. You consume too many resources, you ask for too much. Okay, so network management. Network management really focuses on all the network pieces, and there are a lot of people who really like this domain. The switches, the routers, the subnetworks, the VPNs, all these things that connect all the computers together. So the persona for this type of management is a network administrator. And the network administrator is going to be the person you ask for a new IP address. If you need a new IP, you're going to talk to either the network administrator or someone who is in that group. When I move over here, it makes that noise, doesn't it? No, it's when I move at all. Okay, so the network administrator cares about network bandwidth and availability. They are focused on how fast things are moving between computers. They're kind of like highway people. And quite often in the real world, network administrators and IT administrators don't get along. They blame each other for the problems. One will say that the network is too slow. The other one will say the computers aren't working properly. I wonder if I could switch to that. Too late. So another area for management is storage management. Storage is all about where you put your data. So all of the big, giant spinning disk arrays. Storage management is actually a pretty important discipline today. It has really evolved almost out of nowhere, mostly because of this thing called big data. Has anyone here heard of big data? I hope so. So we are storing massive quantities of data now. massive. And in order to do that, like, it doesn't just go into the air, you actually have to put it onto a disk. So there are storage administrators that we sell to today. They manage the disks themselves. They care about how fast the disks go. They care about their how they're configured. They're the ones who would know exactly which RAID configuration is in use. So virtual infrastructure management is something that you guys should have heard about by now. This is a really important industry trend, I would say, in the last 10 years, but in the last 5 years, it has really become dominant. Almost all systems are now virtualized to one degree or another. This is about getting higher machine density, so more abstract computer instances on a single piece of hardware. Can you hear me? No. Yes? You can hear me okay? Okay, I'll try not to move. Except my mouth. Okay, so virtual, it's not coming through the speakers though, is it? It is? Okay, all right. So virtualization is all about different virtualization technologies, things like VMware or Hyper-V. How many people here have heard of VMware? Hopefully, yeah. Well, you guys should have, but I'm concerned about these guys. So you emulate the hardware using software. So you use, you know, VMware's software on top of a server to make it have 10 machines or 20 machines, and then you can move them around. See, I moved again. So the virtual infrastructure management is an evolution of infrastructure management. So quite often it's the same person or similar people in the same group who have started doing this work. So the persona is a virtualization administrator, and these are people that we at Dell really like a lot because they have a lot of money. I'm going to turn it off entirely. Can you hear me okay? No? Oh, we're going to try this one. Wait a minute, you did hear me. How about now? Yes, good. I don't get a lot of cord though. All right. Hopefully I don't trip. So a virtualization administrator might be called an ESX administrator or a VMware administrator, but the bottom line is they're very much like an infrastructure person, but they are dealing with an extra layer of software. So we met a whole bunch of these. In fact, Yinghua met a whole bunch of these people at VMworld in San Francisco a few weeks ago, right? And these people, they manage VMware for large groups of people who run lots of software. So we get a collision between personas. So this is a very interesting industry trend. Virtualization, because of the software, is becoming so powerful. It doesn't just manage the machine resources. You can set up virtual networks. You can set up virtual storage and storage fabrics. So an awful lot of things are consolidating in the virtualization administrator's domain. So we see virtualization administrators who are now managing the entire infrastructure, including the network and including storage. But it's not the same everywhere you go. Some places they're still separated. Some places the network administrators are still separate, but storage lives in here. So it's a very complicated world out there. So database management is another area that's part of application concerns. So database management really focuses on the performance of the database. And the reason that this has been a very popular domain for many years, like 30 or 40 years, is because the database is where everything ends up, mostly. So almost all enterprise services store something in a database of some form. And so this database person, they really care about how the database works, so how it's structured, the indexes, how fast it runs, how fast the SQL runs, what your SQL looks like, how it can be optimized. They want to know who's writing bad SQL and why they're sending it to their database. So the database administrator, and we call them DBAs, stands for database administrator, they manage a set of databases, and they are traditionally very powerful. They have a lot of money, and they have a lot of ability to change how an application performs. So the last domain I'm going to talk about is application management. So this is an area that focuses on the service that's being provided by all these different elements. So it's a top-down domain. When you're doing application management, you're not looking at a box or the network or a storage array. You're really concerned with what you're trying to do for people. You're concerned with the website. How is it performing? Can people access it? So the persona here is an application administrator. And this is a new type of person that we've been running into in the last, say, 5 years. They are evolving, or they're becoming powerful because there's a lot of dissatisfaction with all these different areas. So when you walk into a company like, there's a bank in Canada called Scotiabank, and they have infrastructure people, and they have virtual infrastructure people, and they have Java people and database people, and they can't get anything done because they all fight with one another all the time. So application administrators are people who are supposed to help solve that problem by focusing on the application itself. Okay, so what does this mean? It means there are a lot of tools. So when we go into a typical enterprise to try and help that company do something, they will have tons of tools. They usually have all of our competitors and some of our stuff. There's a lot of division right now. There are also a lot of social concerns. So when you go into a company, people don't really know who's responsible for a problem. So what's the most important thing to focus on? Well, everybody does some form of infrastructure management. Database has been important in the past, but what we believe, and the reason we're here talking to you, is because we believe application management is the way things will be done in the future. So what is an application? So the definition that I use, and I think, Joe, you like this definition, so I don't know, do you use it again? Good. An application is a collection of software and hardware that provides a service to a set of users. So a good example of an application would be the registration service for your courses, if you have an online registration service. Or, large application would be something like Google or Yahoo or whatever the Chinese equivalents are. I've forgotten what they are. You told me many times that they're better. So a modern application runs on the internet using web-based user interfaces and central servers. So there is, we really focus on internet-based applications, although an application can run just inside of a company. So you can get a custom application that does things like serving up employee vacation data. So how many days vacation did I take last year? I can enter it into a little web application. That's an HR system. So there are lots of different architectures, and I'm running out of time, so I'm going to go a little bit fast through some of the less important ones. So you can have a simple client architecture, which would be an application that just runs on one machine. So something like Microsoft Word or iTunes. The ones we care about most are the web-based ones. So these are ones that run in a browser on a machine or a phone. And the browser talks to a back-end application infrastructure, and it serves up basically HTML and JavaScript to a client. Now, where that runs gets very interesting, and that's where we have a lot of tools to help people understand where things run. It might be running inside of the company's infrastructure. It might be running in a hosting environment. It might be running in a cloud. It might be running in all three at the same time. And where it runs might depend on the time of the year or the load of the application. So this is a sort of basic application architecture. Very generic. There are lots of different kinds of architectures. The main elements of this one, made it. There's usually a web server layer. And this is important because you want to serve up a lot of your static content. And there's typically a middle layer that I can almost point to. I don't have enough cord. Right there. That does a lot more of the business logic. And then the database is at the back end. This is pretty normal. So this is a two-tier application architecture. This one has no business layer. And this is very common. In fact, Facebook used to look very much like this. web servers with databases at the back end. Facebook would have been PHP and MySQL back in the day, like maybe 10 years ago. And this is a common architecture. It's basically a website architecture. Now, the reason that you end up moving to a three-tier architecture is because the processing that you do inside of the web layer becomes too complex for those containers. So if you're running something like Apache or Tomcat, there's only so much that you can do inside of the web server. You really need that more powerful back end, and you move to an application server like JBoss or WebLogic, or maybe you're running .NET. So that middle tier does a lot more of the complex business processing. But this is what we see more in the real world now. And there was a picture like this earlier in the presentation. So you get the same kind of application structure, but the applications talk to each other. So you may go into a typical company, and they may have 10 applications, and they talk to each other over this middle layer called an information bus. And the information bus is a way of exchanging data between the applications. And in some cases, and I don't know if I have another slide or not. Nope. In some cases, that information bus may be used to communicate with applications that are outside of the company's control. So you may go to, you may have an application that calls an external API out on the internet to get some data and pull it back. Or you may have an agreement to have, what the heck's that doing? I'll get rid of that. Or you may have an agreement with a company like Salesforce.com to store certain data there, and you may make an API call to call some of that data back and bring it into your application. So what's really important about this is when we go out with application monitoring, application management, we don't have an expected architecture. Everybody has a different architecture. They're all different. We orient our software, as you'll see over the next couple of sessions, we orient our software anticipating that everything will be different every time we run. And that's hard. Okay. So, you know, what have I been saying? There's significant complexity in applications today. They have multiple layers. They use different technologies, different vendors. They have quite often a shared infrastructure that may be changing in real time at runtime. There's a lot of shared code these days. So it used to be, when I was growing up, that all of the software that you were running in your application was written by either yourself or someone you knew, someone you could talk to, someone who was sitting next to you. These days, we use so many open source frameworks and so many third-party libraries that the vast majority of code that you're running in an application wasn't written by you or anyone you know. And that's the truth. There are lots of external internet services that get used as well. And then you can't emphasize this enough. The infrastructure is so complex today. You don't just run on a machine that you own. You run on a machine that's virtualized, or you run on a cloud. And, you know, depending on the load of your application, you may do this thing called cloud bursting, which is, you know, I normally run on my on-premise machines, but when the load becomes really heavy, I add these Amazon cloud instances to my application, and I run extra machines. That happens. So, you know, the infrastructure changes, and it may be different day to day. So, defining application performance management. So we need to, in APM, application performance management, we want to ensure the availability and performance of an application to deliver business value. So availability is it running? Is it up or down? Performance is it running as expected? How long do the URLs take? How many transactions are we able to process in a given time? And then the business value is really hard to assess, but is it really doing what it needs to? We don't focus on that too much, although there are some metrics that we can pull that help us understand whether or not business value is being delivered. So, for example, how many orders have you processed? If I'm running a bookstore online, how many books did I sell today? That is a metric that tells me about business value. Oh, there we go. That's everything that I just said. So when we talk about availability, we want to know about the uptime of all the components. We want to make sure that the URLs respond. For performance, we typically look at request response time. And also throughput, so the number of transactions or the number of calls to the application per minute, per second. We really care very much about the response time of end-user transactions. So we care about what the user is experiencing. Does it take the user 1 second to load a page, 10 seconds, or does it time out? That's very important, because if it times out, they're not going to buy a book. We also care about resource utilization. We care about, especially in application performance management, we care about all the domains. So we care about the response time to understand if there is a problem, and then we want to measure how the infrastructure is doing so we can see why there is a problem. Are we having problems because we don't have enough CPU assigned to a machine? Are we having problems because we've run out of memory? It happens. So those are other metrics that we gather. So application administrators they really care about making sure that it's available and performing well and that we're delivering the business value. So in order to do that, because this application administrator kind of lives in a world where there are lots of other people with different concerns, network management, infrastructure management, they have to provide proof. So the application person comes in and they say, the application's not performing because this computer crashed. And the infrastructure guy's going to say, oh yeah? Show me. Show me that it crashed, because as far as I know, I think it's running fine. Or, you know, the application's not performing because I ran out of disk space because you didn't give me enough space. The storage management person wants proof. So we need to be able to provide proof to all the other people who participate in supporting the application. And that's why when we do APM, when we do application performance management, we need to monitor all the domains to a degree. And we don't need to know very fine details about the hardware or the operating system, but we do need to know from the perspective of the application what is gone wrong. So these are some of the different platforms that we run into. I don't think this is very interesting, and in the interest of time, I'm going to move along. So now I'm going to talk about some of the different monitoring approaches that we take. So different things that are different ways we gather data in order to make sure an application is running properly. So on the infrastructure side, there are a whole bunch of things that we can do to measure. One of them is this protocol called the Simplified Network Management Protocol, or SNMP. And it is most often used for hardware-level data. So you can access a Dell PowerEdge server with an SNMP and find out, you know, how hot the CPUs are running. Okay, you can find out how much power is being consumed. We also use standard vendor libraries from the operating systems to find out exactly what's going on at the OS layer. There are APIs on the Windows side, WMI and its web service version, WSMAN, and they do, again, OS level performance counters. So this is very good for infrastructure measurement. We also use that. We use SSH, but not the way you think. SSH is not a protocol that gives you any metrics, but you can use it to run commands, and those commands can give you a metric. So believe it or not, a lot of our host monitoring or computer system monitoring is as simple as opening up an SSH session, running a command that gives you information on the command line, and then parsing that data. So we use a command like ps on Unix or Linux to get information about the processes that are running and how much memory they're consuming. On the infrastructure side, we get this into this thing called Virtual Center for VMware. Virtual Center is a management piece that gathers all the information about what VMware is doing. So all the ESX servers, how they're related, what virtual machines are running. So we use Virtual Center an awful lot for virtualization. On the Java side, there are a lot of interesting APIs. So how many people here are Java programmers? A few? They still teach it? Good. So the Java virtual machine itself offers some standard interfaces for accessing profiling data. So you can get detailed data about all of the memory that's been consumed by what objects, and also a whole bunch of performance data, even profiling data down to the line of code. Generally, we don't use that for management because the overhead is too high. What we do instead is a few other techniques. One of them is using JMX. How many people here have heard of JMX before? Should be almost nobody, I would guess. So it stands for Java Management Extensions. It's basically a set of objects that can be running, or it's an interface that gives you access to a set of objects that are running inside of a Java container. So there are standard objects that have been defined for telling us things like how frequently are you garbage collecting, or what's your heap size, what are the heap parameters that you're using. So we use that, we gather that data, and also the application servers themselves, so WebLogic, WebSphere, JBoss, they all make their own JMX mbeans, so they create their own objects that have even more performance data. So we basically go into a Java server and pull out object data. Another thing that we do in the Java world that's interesting is that we insert our own instrumentation into the Java server to do request response time measurement. So we can measure the amount of time that's taken for a JDBC call or for a particular method call. And this used to be very novel. It's actually very common now. You may have heard the term bytecode instrumentation. So we do that, and we basically can modify the Java code without significantly changing its performance. Something that is unique to us, or to a degree unique, is the ability to insert tags. So we can actually put tags onto a Java call stream and then have that tag transmitted from one app server to another application server so that we can chain together multiple Java instances into a single transaction. We call it transaction tracing. I think we have a patent for it, right? So that's something that's unique, and it's an interesting approach. Same kind of things can be done in .NET. Okay, so there's actually an API that will give you stack traces, so you can do stack trace sampling, but you can also do bytecode instrumentation for .NET. On web servers, basically there's not an awful lot of data that you can gather from web servers. There certainly aren't any standards. Tomcat lets you get at some of the basic JVM stuff. On the Apache side, we just scrape the logs mostly. In the database world, if you want to gather metrics from the database, typically a database has a whole series of tables that you can query for performance data. But one thing that we do, it says Quest, it should say Dell, we actually have a product called Performance Analyzer, and it reverse engineers the memory image of the database and pulls out SQL plan data from that memory image. It's a very complex product, but it produces a lot of really great data at almost no overhead to the database. So we aren't querying the database to find out why it's slow. You can skip packaged apps. So on the end user side, I have until what time? 5:20 or 3:20? Okay, I'll cover this quickly. So end-user monitoring is really about measuring the end-user experience. And there are three basic techniques that Joe is going to cover a little bit more later. One is synthetic transactions, which basically means I code up a URL and I send it to the application server, or I send it to the application, and I measure how long it takes. That's a synthetic transaction. You can also do browser instrumentation, which means you modify your web server's code and insert instrumentation that measures response time from the perspective of the browser. So it's real end-user instrumentation. It doesn't require us to deploy any extra monitoring software. The main technique that we use is packet sniffing. Is that it then? So we're done? No. No, we're not done. We have to keep going. Okay. I have five more slides, maybe. Should I finish? You can pick up the next one. I'm lying. It's 9. So I'll go very quickly. We have a technique called packet sniffing, which basically means we look at the network, we pick out all of the requests, and we can put back together an end-user response time. To do that, we have to deploy a piece of software inside of the company's firewall to do that. It's complicated. and expensive. I'll skip network. So, all right, we are done. That's it. So what have we covered? We talked about different concerns, the infrastructure monitoring, network storage. We introduced application performance management. We defined an application. We talked about the architectures, and then I talked about the different metric gathering techniques for the different domains. And no, that's not what's next. Okay, thank you.